Well, hello there. I'm Green Dean, and welcome to EatTheWeeds.com. I'm putting together a series of videos for my friends and you about the edible plants that are in your backyard and your fields and your woods around you, because I have a lot of friends who are green, but they don't know about greenery. So I thought this would be an interesting and fun way to do that, and you get to learn something too at the same time. Now, I'm here in my backyard in Central Florida, and we haven't had a freeze here in 7 years until 2 weeks ago, so the number of edibles in my backyard has been reduced a little, but there's still plenty here, and that's my point. I want to show you that just by sitting in basically an unkept backyard, there are a lot of things to eat, because nature doesn't know the difference between a cultivated plant and a weed, and to it, just whatever survives. So let's just take a look around here for a slight survey, and we'll see what we got here. Over here is a Biden's alba, also was known as Biden pilosa. It's not too attractive right here, I'll admit that, but young and tender. Take the leaves off, throw them in a pot, add some water, cook them up, quite nice. And let's see. Oops. See, you know, you can tell we're not rehearsed because that leaf fell on me without any prompting. I gotta reach for this. Here we go. Wild lettuce. Yes, there is such a thing, because before there was cultivated lettuce, there was wild lettuce. Young and tender again. You want to put it in your pot and a little water in there and use it like a spinach. The thing about wild lettuce is one of the very, very few wild plants that has a white sap. Normally white sap is a big warning flag that you should stay away, but there are a few exceptions. Figs, for example, have white sap, and wild lettuce does. So while you don't eat it raw, because it's a bit on the bitter side, once you cook it, the bitterness goes away. It's a very nice potter. As far as other things sitting here, over here, an Asiatic dayflower. If you go to my website, eattheweeds.com, you'll find a lot about this little plant. Actually, you find more about its relative, but it applies the same thing. It's a Triscanth. This is actually a Commelina, but the Commelinas and the Triscanthias are in the same family. The blog on that is called Pocahontas and Gamma Rays. It's at eattheweeds.com, and if you read Pocahontas and Gamma Rays, you'll know all you want to know about eating these little fellas and where they came from. It's kind of pretty. It's got a blue flower. I don't know if you can tell that or not. It has three petals, two large blue petals and one smaller blue petal, and there's a nice story behind that. The nice thing about this and other greens is that they stay edible all year round. This and the other, its relative, the Triscanthia, don't get rank as the season goes on. And very, very nice. And you can also, you know, quite tasty. Should wash the sand off that first. Another one I want to tell you about right here is this one. Can you see that? Isn't that nice? This is an Oxalis corymbosa, I believe. See, it's growing in a clump, and that's what a clump means. Of course, it also might be, they also call it, it's a sorrel. They also call it the lilac shamrock. Two versions of it grow here in Central Florida, and this is the pink one. I've never seen the other one, but it's very tasty. I used to think it tasted like a Granny Smith apple, but actually it's more like not so sour rhubarb. You throw them in salads now and then. French make a soup out of it. The only caution is it has oxalic acid, so you can't eat a lot of them. You know, if you ate it the same amount as like bushel feeding a rat something or other, get them sick, then, you know, that would work, like they do in labs. But so very, very nice. Pardon me. I haven't had lunch yet. But, sorry. Shouldn't eat in front of people. let's see, what else do I have here? I've done the thou thistle. Hawksweed. Well, Creps japonica, way over there, I shan't go get it. It's in the composite family. Quite edible, shows up in a lot of lawns. Here's a great one. Stachys floridana, also known as a Florida betony. Now, this is not the part you eat. If you ate it, it might not make you sick, but not probably doesn't taste too good either. It has a root that's about the shape of your little finger. It kind of looks like a white grub. And in its cousin is called Stachys affinis. Well, pardon my Latin, but I'm Greek, and if I don't care how I pronounce a dead language. So the roots of this one sell for about $18 to $20 a pound in gourmet restaurants in New York City and Chicago and places like that. The root here in Florida, I mean, they're virtually identical, almost identical. Taste the same, look the same, used in the same way. People knew that they actually had virtually thousands of dollars of these things in their lawn, they'd probably sell their lawn. There are a lot of recipes for these on the internet. I never use them because they never get to my kitchen. I just kind of take them out of the garden and off they go. I mean, you might find that hard to believe, but I actually do eat the plants in my yard. And what else do I have here? So, Stachys affinis. Very, very nice. And if there's anything else here, just to demonstrate in your backyard, an unkept backyard.
Yes.
Over here. What's not to lichen about lichen? This is reindeer moss, and it's probably older than I am, but we won't get into that. It's probably older than you are. We won't get into that either. Three interesting things about moss, or lichen, is first of all, it's 94% carbohydrates. That's a huge amount of carbohydrates. That's 14% more carbohydrates than the potatoes. And because it's 14% more carbohydrates than potatoes, at one time it was used to make an awful lot of booze. And back in the 1800s, Sweden led the world in lichen brandy and lichen vodka and lichen everything else that had alcohol in it. And the Russians got involved too. The Russians even made a molasses out of this. But you have to prepare it correctly. These little buggers have got a lot of acid in them that can really do a number on your stomach. So you have to prepare them right before you possibly eat them. If you want to know about that, you go to eattheweeds.com and you'll learn about that. So the point of it all is there are plenty of things in your backyard that you can eat in the fields out there, and you can do it. You can tell the difference between it's easy to tell an edible plant. You can tell the difference between a dog and a cat or a dog and a fox. And the problem with identifying and eating wild greens and things and other plants is not identifying them. The problem is the soil. The problem is the water. Has it been polluted? And that's what most brings greenery to home to you and bring in environmentalism, is that when you go to the interstate and you realize there's a fantastic persimmon tree, absolutely full of fruit that you can't eat. You can't eat because it sits in exhaust all day long. It has cadmium, lead, asbestos, rubber, paint, motor oil, grease. That's when you realize how polluted the environment is. When you realize that there's a world of edible food around you that you can't eat because somebody else is polluting it. And that's why learning about plants that you can eat has impact. It brings to home the problem of pollution. In all my years of gathering wild foods, I've never been made ill by the plant I picked. But a couple of times I've been ill because the soil or the water the plant was in was not good. And so that's where it becomes the challenge. That's where it brings being green home. And that's why it's important, is to make this place more wholesome. And so next time, I think I'll probably talk about some of the, not rules, but some of the things we do in foraging that keeps us healthy and happy and going. So until next time, this is Green Dean. I want you to think green and eat green. Well, you know what I mean. Toodles. Oh, there's a nice little bee there. Look at that. He's sitting on a hawk's beard. Honeybee. Now that's environmentalism.